The Practical Mystic, A Guide to Psychic and Intuitive Skills, written by Colin Clark and read by Colin Clark. Hello, I'm Colin Clark, and welcome to the audio journey through my book, The Practical Mystic, A Guide to Psychic and Intuitive Skills. To begin with, I'm going to introduce you to how I started out on my own journey, at the end of which I'll give you some guidance as to how I'd like you to take this journey you're about to embark on. At the end of the day, though, how you do it is up to you. So like everything in this book, I'll guide and give pointers rather than tell you what to do. The book's designed as a journey with a beginning, a middle, and an end. And if you go one step at a time through the exercises, then you'll get a good grounding in a process designed to help you to develop your psychic and intuitive abilities. The book is split into two parts. Part one is the main book and exercises, and part two, which is much shorter, carries some additional exercises, pointers, and a few anecdotes from my experience of using my psychic and intuitive skills over the last 20 years. One thing I would like you to do, though, if you can, is approach this journey with a light heart and an easy attitude. That way you'll have fun as you go along. There's no need to take it all too seriously, even though you'll come across a few serious bits. The idea is for you to enjoy yourself, and my view is that if you're having fun, then learning is a lot easier. Introduction. Sometimes we get a glimpse of what we might call intuition. We may even think of these brief insights as demonstrations of our innate psychic ability, and then get a surge of excitement as a result. Now, these glimpses sometimes make us want to know more and, if possible, find out if we can develop these abilities. However, these brief insights happen so infrequently for most of us that we wonder if they're real or not, or have any real value in our daily lives. I have to say that I was a skeptical person for most of my adult life. I'd had the odd moment of excitement when I thought I'd experienced a tiny glimmer of being psychic, or at best intuitive. I didn't take these moments seriously, and like most of us, I forgot all about them. It was only after I had what I can only call my first truly psychic experience that my opinion changed, and I felt compelled to explore psychic abilities further. I became really curious, and I wanted to find out if I had any ability at all. The difficulty came when I tried to find a way to learn how to be psychic. In the end, it took a long time to develop my ability, and it was a bit of a wild goose chase. Now, it's not uncommon to want to run before you can walk, but the process of learning the skills I wanted felt as if I was permanently crawling along at a snail's pace. The way I'd like to have learned was in a concise and clearly designed way that didn't take forever. Now, that didn't seem too much to ask until I realised how many different ideas and beliefs there were about psychic abilities, and yet how few people there were who could teach the skills. Many years ago, I trained as a therapist in NLP, that's neuro-linguistic programming, and hypnotherapy. I continued part-time training for 5 years in total, and then worked for a few years doing one-to-one therapy and counselling sessions. I felt that the skills I'd developed could be useful tools to explore how psychic abilities worked, and I also had a secret desire to teach others how to develop the skills. When I used my training to work out what it was that gave rise to psychic and intuitive abilities, it came as a great surprise that there were only a few simple steps that anyone needed to know. As a result, I wrote up a basic model of how this amazing yet subtle ability worked, and then put together the steps necessary for anyone to learn the skills. Even after a couple of years of researching and confirming that my process worked, I still found it hard to believe that it was so simple. I was still quite sceptical, so I did nothing with my model for a few years, and became embroiled in real life. A few years later, I had a conversation about psychic abilities over a few drinks with an astrology friend. He was intrigued and decided to set me a challenge to put my model to the test by teaching it to a group of people that he'd helped pull together. So I decided to run a short half-day course and find out if my process really worked. When the day of the course came, I was excited, but also pretty apprehensive, as I secretly feared that the course would flop and I'd make a fool of myself. To my surprise, all the participants got good results, and that's in their view, not just mine. And they were keen to learn more. Now this gave me a spur of confidence. So over the next couple of years, I turned my model into a range of courses, training dozens of students how to develop their innate psychic abilities. My students came from a wide variety of backgrounds and life experience, and no two people had the same reason for doing my courses. I learned many things from my students, but what I grew to realise most was that there was something at the core of psychic and intuitive abilities that spoke to a much deeper part of each student. Learning these skills touches something deeply personal, and developing these abilities has real meaning in a person's life. This was brought home to me when I thought back to when I first encountered the world of psychics and mediums. Back in 1995, I went to what I thought was going to be a talk about clairvoyance. Even though I thought the whole thing was probably a complete fraud, I was curious to know what the speaker had to say. It turned out to be a demonstration of clairvoyance by a local medium in a backstreet cafe in Cheltenham. Having sat down, I realised I couldn't leave without seeming rude. The idea of mediumship scared me a little, but seeing the medium's cheerful delivery and listening to his slightly crass jokes and mildly offensive ribbing of the audience, I became amused and a little curious about what mediumship might really be about. The medium's name was Tony, and we chatted afterwards over a cup of coffee and a stale cake. He quickly realised that I was a sceptic, and said that the only way to get over my scepticism was to try a basic exercise to see if I got a result. I was then free to make up my own mind. I had nothing to lose, and the one thing I can't resist is my own curiosity. So we met one evening at my little rented cottage, had a bite to eat, had some entertaining conversation, and then Tony asked if I had any candles that I could light to make the atmosphere a little more conducive to the exercise we were going to do. He then said he was going to see if I could gather any information for him based on my contact with his 9-carat gold signet ring, and told me this exercise was called psychometry, which I'd never heard of before. Tony handed me the ring and told me to take a deep breath, focus on the object, rub my fingers over it, and close my eyes if I needed to in order to shut out the world. I had no clue what I was doing. After about 10 minutes of silence while he sat there patiently, I still had nothing. I felt disappointed and told him I obviously didn't have any ability. He smiled and told me I could be right, but to humour him and take another breath, close my eyes and let my mind be as blank as possible. He told me to relax and then begin to notice anything that I could use to tell a story that related to my contact with the ring. And with nothing to lose, I had another go. Straight away, I saw a room with a small galley-type kitchen next to it. I could smell fried food. There was a woman cooking, and I could see she had sausagey fingers, similar to Tony, so I felt this was his mother. She was quite overweight and seemed really grumpy as well. I told him the living room was painted all over in a single pale colour, and even the fireplace was painted in the same colour. I told him about what looked like Dad's chair that no one else was allowed to sit in. I said that he had two sisters, one of whom fussed around his father, always trying to get on his good side. And I also told Tony that he and his wife lived in a room next to the living room, and that there was an issue between his wife and his mother. The issue was that although his mother didn't object to his wife's cooking, she objected to the way she cooked. Tony didn't say anything during my story, and when I finished, I told him that it was a good tale, but probably just a bunch of made-up nonsense coming from my imagination. He was silent for a few seconds, then took the ring back from me. I said I may as well not kid myself into thinking I could do anything psychic. He gave me a moment to get over my disappointment, then told me everything I'd said was true. The house where he and his wife lived when first married was his parents' house. The living room was painted lilac, including the fireplace, as it was the favourite colour of one of his two sisters. The issue between his mother and his wife was about the way his wife cooked. All the other details were correct too. I was stunned. I knew nothing about Tony's past or anything about his family. I remember feeling elated, if a little unprepared, to discover this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.